When do we use seclusion and restraint in New Zealand, and who do we use it on? The answers aren't great, or even close to great, to be frank. A new report published today by the Human Rights Commission reveals an indefensible, it seems, over-reliance on seclusion and restraint, particularly of Māori and Pasifika in our prisons, children and young people's residences, and health and disability units too. This isn't new. It follows a highly critical 2017 review of seclusion and restraint practices in New Zealand, also published by the New Zealand Human Rights Commission. So what improvements have there been in the past 3 years? Not nearly enough is the short answer. Joining us now from Wellington for this important conversation and possibly a longer and more nuanced response, not nearly enough, is Paul Hunt, Chief Human Rights Commissioner. Paul, it's so nice to have you with us as always. Thank you for this work. It's really important. The disproportionality of Māori and Pasifika in seclusion. Can we address that first of all? Because it's really striking. The use of seclusion in women's prisons, 3/4 of the women who end up in seclusion are Māori women.
Kia ora, John. This is a real problem. This report is serious, and it's very disappointing, and it confirms a number of the reports that have been issued by the Ombudsman and the Children's Commissioner. One of the issues is there is insufficient data collected on the issues to which you've just referred about possible gender bias, racial bias. There needs to be better collection of data so that we can tackle this problem. But John, one of the things that strikes me about this report is that it's really fair. It's really balanced. This international expert does acknowledge that there have been improvements, and we do need to acknowledge that there have been some positive improvements in relation to the work of the detaining agencies, Department of Corrections, Ministry of Health and District Health Boards, Arangatamariki. But nonetheless, there is a big problem. She talks about the significant increase, John, in the use of mechanical restraints and pepper spray. This is going in the opposite direction from what she was recommending and what agencies have been trying to do three years ago. There are also notable variations between different prisons, yes, suggesting that there isn't a uniform policy.
Yeah, that there is real subjectivity at work, right? So because if there's variation from prison to prison, then that is personal decision-making is coming into play. I want to talk about where there haven't been improvements. Youth justice, I'm really struck by those numbers. 298 occasions, a total of 815 days in this report versus 307 days in 2016-17. So the use of seclusion, isolation, restraint is going up.
Yeah, in some cases it definitely is. Solitary confinement, over half identify as Māori young people in solitary confinement, and that it's more than doubled from 3 years ago when we first asked Dr. Shalev to do this report. I mean, one has to say that there is an increase in the number of shorter solitary detention, but nonetheless, overall, we're going in the wrong direction. And it's the same in the disability and health facilities, John. There's a real problem. There's a real problem there too. Again, with Māori being grossly overrepresented, the average number of seclusion events per person rose in health and disability facilities. And this confirms something that the Ombudsman said just a few months ago.
Yeah, and we talked about it at the time. So we're talking about some of the most vulnerable people in our community. And I want to bring in, Paul, now a picture we have from your report, I think page 19 of the report from memory. So this is a windowless ICU room, and I just want people to see it so they know what we're talking about. Now, people are spending up to 23 hours a day in these rooms, right? And these, so I can't imagine spending 23 hours a day in this space. What is the experience of prolonged, sustained seclusion like?
Oh, well, there's an abundant evidence that it has a damaging effect physiological effect and psychological effect. There's no question about that. And particularly on children and disabled people. There's overwhelming evidence. And it's also known that sometimes solitary confinement can amount to the definition of torture, cruel and inhuman, degrading treatment. This is what we're facing. And a new approach, I think, is needed, John. There needs to be more attention to alternative therapeutic approaches.
Brilliant. So let's talk about that, because I know there'll be people out there saying, if somebody is really problematic and they constitute a risk to other people in the facility or staff members, what do we do? What's the alternative so that we're not putting people for prolonged periods, 23 hours a day in rooms like that?
Well, there are alternatives, therapeutic alternatives. One of the problems, John, is overcrowding in the facilities and understaffing, which means staff, many of whom are trying really hard to do a good job, but they're not in a position to do the sort of job that they want to do because of overcrowding the facilities and because of understaffing. There are alternatives that we've got to explore which aren't as punitive and ineffective as the present ones.
You've talked about this. The Human Rights Commission has blown the whistle on this practice 3 years ago. There have been some improvements and some deteriorations. The Chief Ombudsman, we've had him on the program talking about this stuff. At what stage are we going to get exasperated? And is anyone listening, Paul?
Well, I suppose that one has to acknowledge that there are some improvements on which we must build. But there are some basic things that could be done. I mean, for instance, in relation to children, we can simply stop solitary confinement. I mean, that's what seclusion means. It's solitary confinement. So we can stop solitary confinement for children and young people, provided the right facilities are there and provided the right staff are there. We need to reduce the length of seclusion and the number of restraints for adults. We've got to investigate this great challenge of racial and gender bias, and we must explore taking into account te ao Māori. We've got to explore alternative, therapeutic, restorative approaches.
Chief Human Rights Commissioner Paul Hunt, thank you so much for joining us this morning. We're going to take what you said and we're going to go to the Minister and try and get a response, because this is really important work. If you were saying it for the first time, then perhaps we could be forgiven for our inaction. But this is the second time you've said it. Other agencies have been saying it. So we appreciate you persevering and we'll try and get a response. Thank you so much for joining us this morning.
Kia ora, John. Thank you.